Hariyo. In this video, we discuss the property of a rotating body called moment of inertia. Inertia, you all know that it is the inability of a body to change its state of state by itself. That is studied in linear motion. And there we found that inability is measured in terms of mass of the body. So linear inertia is measured in terms of mass of the body. That means mass increases, the inertia, linear inertia is also increasing. And you studied many examples relating to that also. But here we are discussing for a rotating body is also having an inability to change its state of rotation by itself. And that inability of a rotating body to change its state of rotation by itself is known as rotational inertia. It's called rotational inertia. And this rotational inertia is measured in terms of what you call moment of inertia, or the measure of rotational inertia is called moment of inertia. Okay? Now, what is actually this moment of inertia, or how we can express the moment of inertia of a rotating body? For that, we consider a rigid body. I consider a rigid body which is rotating about an axis X. So X is the axis about which this body is rotating. Then I can consider the mass particles as m1 at a vertical distance r1 from the axis, and m2 at a vertical distance R2. Okay? Like that, I can have Mn at a vertical distance Rn from the axis of rotation. And as the body is moving around with a definite angular velocity omega, then as the body moves around, this omega will remain constant for all the mass particles in this body because the body is a rigid one. Okay? That means when the body rotates once around, the whole mass particles of the body is completing one rotation within the same time. That means omega remain constant. But as the body moves around, you can see that m1 will be having a linear velocity of v1, m2 has a linear velocity v2, and mn is having a linear velocity of vn. And this v1, v2, vn, etc. are not constant because this tangential or linear velocity it is changing depending upon the distance from the axis of rotation. That means we have a formula that v1 equal to r1 omega and v2 is equal to r2 omega and v3, like that it goes as vn equal to rn omega. So as the distance from the axis is changing, the tangential speed of the mass particles is also changed. And therefore, if I calculate the kinetic energy of this rotating body, that kinetic energy of the rotating body will be equal to, kinetic energy is equal to half m v1 square plus half m2 v2 square plus etc. plus half mn vn square, I could write. Okay. Therefore, if I substitute this one into it, the kinetic energy therefore will be equal to half into m 1 r 1 omega square plus half m 2 r 2 omega square, like that half m n r n omega the whole square I will get. So this is the total kinetic energy of the body rotating around. I have taken that energy in terms of each mass particle. And therefore, if I rewrite this as kinetic energy, therefore will be equal to half m1 r1 square into omega plus half m2 r2 square into omega plus etc. plus half mn rn square into omega. That means if I rewrite it, I can take a quantity like this. Okay. And therefore this can be written as half into m1 r1 square plus m2 r2 square plus etc. plus mn rn square into omega I could write, and this can be written as kinetic energy therefore will be taken as half into I into omega square. So kinetic energy of the rotating body for this rigid body can be taken like this, that I am taking the bracket quantity as I, that I equal to m1 r1 square plus m2 r2 square plus etc. plus mn rn square. So this quantity I am taking it as I, and that is nothing but the moment of inertia of the rotating body about the axis of rotation. Now how I am comparing this is that kinetic energy of translatory motion, kinetic energy of the translatory motion can be taken as half m v square. Okay, then kinetic energy of the rotation can be taken as half I omega square. And as I compare this and this, the mass in this one represents the translational inertia of the body, and at the same time I in this one will be representing the rotational inertia part, and this moment of inertia should be, because v is the linear velocity, the omega is the angular velocity, and as we compare, the value of I must be the rotational inertia. So I am taking that as the measure of rotational inertia, that is moment of inertia of the body. Okay, so moment of inertia, from this statement we got that moment of inertia depends on, actually for the mass particle it is coming as mass into square of the distance from the axis of rotation. So in short, if I take the simplified formula for this one, that is for the mass m1 from the axis of rotation r1, that the moment of inertia for that small moment of inertia will be equal to m1 r1 square. That means the moment of inertia of the mass m depends on mass of the body and also square of the distance from the axis of rotation. That means that the mass distribution is far away from the axis of rotation, or the distance of from the axis is increasing, you can see that the moment of inertia is increasing. That you might have noticed that suppose you tie a stone with a small length of wire and rotate it, it is easy to stop that rotation. But if you are rotating that same stone with a lengthy wire and rotating around, whirling around, the stopping that mass will be little bit difficult, that its moment of inertia is increasing. Okay? Understood? Then, another thing is that as the mass increases, then also the moment of inertia is increasing. Alright? So, this is all about the moment of inertia of the body, about the axis of rotation. Another thing is that the unit of moment of inertia is kilogram into meter square, and its dimensional formula is m raised to 1, l raised to 2, t raised to 0. Okay? And depending upon this, I can write for a given mass, the moment of inertia can be obtained as out of this rigid body concept. If I take the rigid body concept, it's a single body, and I am taking the small mass dm at a distance r, then the moment of inertia of the small portion of the mass dm about the axis will be di, which will be equal to dm into r square. You can write it. But at the same time, if I am finding out the moment of inertia of the whole body about the axis of rotation, then I will be getting the total moment of inertia about the axis, that will be equal to integral di, will be equal to integral r square dm from the mass varies from 0 to capital M, you can say. Suppose capital M is the whole mass of the body. Getting it? This is another way to find the moment of inertia. But in this case, I have taken the moment of inertia as the algebraic sum or the discrete sum of mass particles moment of inertia. But here I am taking, let's say, what you call integral sum. It's an integration. Small portion is getting added. So this is the better way to find the moment of inertia of any object, okay, with respect to an axis of rotation. So remember, when we talk about moment of inertia of a body, you should be defining an axis first of all, and about which only you can define the moment of inertia of the body.